Thank you, Premier, for your kind words of welcome. Similarly, Adam. Thank you to the Australia Day Council and Australia Unlimited for being bold enough to employ a POM on this very special occasion. And thank you for the sound of the didgeridoo. It made me feel quite homesick. You see, in England, I live next door to Rolf Harris. I get a rent rebate. The other day, I went to Tasmania for the very first time. And as a friendly gesture of welcome, a local historian gave me a list of Parkinsons who in the early 19th century arrived from England in less salubrious circumstances. The details of their misdemeanors were not revealed, nor was there any evidence that any of them were my ancestors. And yet, looking at that list, I felt more acutely than ever before a sense of kinship with Australia. And looking at the dates of their arrivals from the 1820s to the 1840s, I was able to comprehend with greater clarity than ever the extraordinary achievement of the men and women who, having been dumped in a place as remote and mysterious as the moon, built a democratic and civilized country in a remarkably short time. Now, that for me is the wonder of Australia. And what follows is one man's story of what he found here and why, generally speaking, what he found made him happy and at home, even though home was half a world away. My association with Australia began the day I was born. Upon being told my mother had given birth to a baby boy, my father, as Adam told you, said he would like to add another name to the agreed Michael. He said he wanted to celebrate a recent event in Australia where England had won a test match. Therefore, he would like me baptized Michael Melbourne Parkinson. My mother, aware she was married to a daft cricket tragic, said she too had been thinking about another name. Her choice would be Gershwin, to commemorate her love of movies, starring Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, by celebrating the composer of some of the great music they danced to. Fortunately, they agreed that the chance of bringing up a child named Michael Gershwin Melbourne Parkinson in a pit village in Yorkshire without incident might prove a problem, particularly for the child. So they changed their minds, and thank the Lord they did. Though I wasn't to know it at the time, it was also my introduction to a man, my father, whose entire life, whose very soul and being was dedicated to two loves, his family and cricket, and who, if asked to choose between the two, would have to give the matter some serious thought. His prime ambition was to sit on the hill at Sydney and watch England beat Australia. And the greatest puzzle life held was not the mystery of our existence, but the fact that Don Bradman had a batting average twice that of my father's hero, Len Hutton. My father had a theory that Australians were a breakaway tribe of sunburnt Yorkshiremen. This observation was based entirely upon the way Aussies played their cricket. Tough, aggressive, fiercely competitive, and without compromise. I grew up believing that Australians were, at the very least, distant cousins. The first Aussies I came into contact with were journalists. As a conscripted teenage soldier, I found myself in charge of a group of reporters covering the Suez invasion in the 1950s. Now, these were proper journalists, battle-scarred, grizzled war correspondents, not unraised wannabes like the soldiers supposedly looking after them. The most impressive was a fabled Australian called Ronnie Monson. When General Sir Hugh Stockwell, the officer in charge of the invasion force, organized a party to meet the media, Ronnie turned up wearing twice as many campaign medals as the general. He reported wars long forgotten. He'd also been one of the first journalists to witness the horrors of Belsen concentration camp. I looked upon Ronnie with a mixture of awe and envy. He was the kind of journalist I wanted to be. I wondered if I would measure up, given the chance, and I was soon to find out. I started my career in television in the late 1950s at Granada in Manchester, where the head of current affairs was an Aussie. His name was Tim Hewitt. He He was to play a significant part in my television career, as well as giving me my first insight into the egalitarian ways of Australia. Well, he and a guy called Meb Cutluck, that is. Meb was a newly arrived Australian reporter with a very direct style. One day he had to ring Lord Hailsham, a high-ranking Conservative politician, to try and secure an interview. And being new to the job, he asked me how he should approach the politician. With caution, I advised. I explained Lord Hailsham was an eminent QC called Quinton Hogg, who was not renowned for his love of the Fourth Estate. I said Meb should observe the formalities. He picked up the phone and called Lord Hailsham. Somehow, he got straight through. "G'day, Quint," he said. There was an appalled silence in our office, but Meb got his interview. It was also rumoured he took tea with Quinton Hogg, who no doubt wanted to inspect at close quarters this representative of a strange and plain-speaking tribe hitherto unknown to the noble lord. Now, for someone brought up to conform to the strict boundaries of class and privilege in post-war Britain, to feel inhibited, shackled even, by the limitations imposed by accent, education, and the fact of being a miner's son, for this person to encounter fellow human beings to whom none of these things mattered at all was a joyous revelation. Indeed, I think I truly fell in love with Australia when, years later, I watched the then Prime Minister Paul Keating put his arm around the Queen. Those who believed it was a terrible lapse of protocol that Mr. Keating should be sent to the Tower and tried for treason completely missed the point. Mr. Keating wasn't being disloyal. He was merely reaching out in friendly gesture, one human being to another. In doing so, he was demonstrating a point made by Enid Lorimer, a wonderful old actress I interviewed on my first trip to Australia. Miss Lorimer was born in Victorian England and came to Australia where she had a distinguished career. She was in her 80s when I interviewed her, and we talked about how liberating she found it that Australians rebuked the class system that governed her life in Britain. She said what attracted her most to her adopted country was the lack of snobbery. And she said, "We British invented the word snob. The Australians don't know what it means." She added, "I think snobbery is a form of cruelty, a combination of cruelty and pride. That's why I love Australia, because here we are all human beings." It's that classless aspect of Australians we POMs find so attractive and enviable. So much so, we do love reminding you that however free you think you are, you still constitutionally pay allegiance to a monarch who isn't Australian and who doesn't live here. The Barmy Army taunts you by singing to the tune of Yellow Submarine, "Your next queen is Camilla Parker Bowles, Camilla Parker Bowles." good song, that. Or "God Save Your Noble Queen." The Australian Republican movement should do worse than sign the Barmy Army to provide the soundtrack to their next bid for change. And change there will be. The only question is when. But back to Granada Television and Tim Hewitt. Tim was an audacious Australian who has his own place in the history of British television. His singular achievement was a programme called World in Action, a revolutionary concept at the time whereby he eliminated the on-camera reporter and relied instead on good pictures and a vigorous script. He was a tough boss. I was once filming a messy war in Cyprus when he rang me to order me and my film crew to Zanzibar to report a revolution. "Do you know how far Zanzibar is from Cyprus?" I said testily. He said, "I just looked at the map, it's about 2 inches. He said, "It shouldn't take you long." We were arrested and imprisoned in Zanzibar. When they kicked us out, they drove us around freshly dug graves before taking us to our rescuers. So I was interviewed on the news. I was newsworthy when I returned to England. And this led to me being employed to work in front of camera. So I owe my TV career as a reporter to an Australian producer who didn't believe in them. The irony of that situation did not escape Tim. Many years later, when I was working in Australia for the ABC, and Tim had retired to a farm near Melbourne, I called him and arranged a reunion. We had not met for 10 years or more. He came to my hotel room for a drink. In my room, he spied the list of questions for the talk show I was preparing. Without being invited, he picked it up and began reading. When it finished, I asked him what he thought. "Crap guest, crap interview," he said. He wasn't being unpleasant, and I wasn't upset. In Hewitt's world, the only way to tell a story was his way. My relationship with Tim helped me survive the time I came to work here in the late 70s. In those days, the most daunting prospect of arriving in Sydney was the airport press conference. The first question I received was, "Is it true you're coming to Australia because you can't get a job in England?" In my hotel room, I switched on the radio just in time to hear the host of a phone-in program describe me as a carpetbagger. Far from being disconcerted, I was reassured by the fact that Australia seemed to be full of Tim Hewitts. The fact was, I felt at home. The hospitality of the locals was freely given and comforting. Mark Twain, who also fell in love with Australia, had it exactly right when he described it as English-friendly with English shyness and self-consciousness left out. At that time, the country was still feeling the aftershocks of the constitutional crisis, and big beasts like Bob Hawke and Paul Keating and others were prowling. These men and more besides were to shape Australia's political future by challenging the old guard, while up in Queensland, Joe Bjelke-Petersen began to look more and more like King Canute. In his obituary in the Sydney Morning Herald, they described his role in Queensland as showing, quote, "an almost total disregard for Parliament, the bureaucracy, and convention." I interviewed Joe, and Kerry Packer, who presented what can only be described as a sense of almighty clout. He was, without doubt, one of the most influential Australians of them all, not simply by the power he wielded with his media empire, but because he changed forever and fundamentally the game of cricket. Now, I'll pause there for a moment to let you think about what's coming next. A lot of you will have been wondering just when I was going to mention the great game and the fact we retained the Ashes and beat you 3-1. The answer is I don't really know how I held back for so long. I have no wish to crow or be triumphant, he lied. Indeed, the only reason I introduce the subject now seriously is because anyone who thinks that cricket is merely a game and the Ashes just another sporting contest understands nothing about the relationship between Australia and the mother country. In many ways, cricket defines that relationship, a simmering dispute of catcall and insult spread over 3 different centuries, best explained by the Australian author David Malouf when he wrote, "The symbol of the Ashes, playful as it was, gave Australia a place in popular mythology that none of the other colonies enjoyed. At the same time as exposing the worst of animosity between our two nations, the game also promotes the best examples of familial love. It's allowed our countries to express their rivalry, but more importantly, their mateship, through displays of sportsmanship and unexpected kindness." The most remarkable and telling example of what I mean is embodied in the story of Harold Larwood. Larwood was a working-class Nottinghamshire man of mining stock, a fast bowler commonly accepted as one of the most fearsome of all time. On what became known as the Bodyline Tour in the 1930s, Larwood was the weapon Douglas Jardine, England's captain, chose to destroy Australia's hero, the greatest batsman of all time, Sir Donald Bradman. Jardine, MCC, public school, patrician, loathed Australians, but not half as much as they hated him, particularly when his plan to nullify Bradman's genius involved the simple expedient of bowling at Australian heads. The political storm threatened to strain bonds between our two countries to breaking point, but the most extraordinary circumstance was what happened to Harold Larwood. The establishment of English cricket asked him to take the blame and write a letter apologising for his bowling. Not surprisingly, he told him to shove off and retired from cricket. He moved to Blackpool, and you have to be desperate to move to Blackpool, where he lived anonymously in a sweet shop, a sad recluse, when he should have been a conquering hero. He was rescued from unhappy obscurity by an Australian, a test cricketer who played in the Bradman team in the Bodyline series, who also worked as a journalist in Canberra. His name was Jack Fingleton, and I was proud to call him my friend. First of all, Jack discovered Lawood hiding in Blackpool and then set about convincing him to change his miserable existence for a life in Australia. Lawood laughed at even the thought. "The Aussies loathed him," he said. "Not so," said Jack. "They thought him a great cricketer. It was Jardine they hated." In his perceptive and recently published biography of Harold Lawood, Duncan Hamilton said the bowler was finally convinced by Fingleton talking about Australia the way F. Scott Fitzgerald spoke about America when he described it as, and I quote, "a land commensurate with our capacity to wonder." He made it sound alluring, irresistible. He also convinced Lawood of the Australian principle of giving a bloke a fair go. He smoothed Lawood's passage by using his Canberra contacts, particularly the Prime Minister at the time, Ben Chifley. This led to a bizarre encounter between the two men in the company of Fingleton. As Jack told it, Ben Chifley and Broad Ocker made a welcoming speech to Harold, whereupon the bowler turned to Jack and said, "What did he say?" Lawood returned the compliment, saying, "I want to thank you very much, Mr. Chifley, for being so kind to me and our lass, and we really look forward to settling here. Thank you." And the Prime Minister said to Jack, "What did he say?" Two men divided by a common language. Nonetheless, Lawood quickly settled in Australia, and in his later life, I came to know him. I found a happy and contented man, made so by the warmth and the generosity of the people he settled among. He told the story of his neighbour who called the day after he moved in and said to Harold, "When you played at the Sydney Cricket Ground, I was among those who hated you and booed you. Now you're my neighbour. I want you to know you're most welcome. Anything you need, you only have to ask." Harold Lawood lived a happy life in Australia for 50 years, never regretting the journey, ever grateful for his new beginning. He died aged 91, and sometime before his death he said, "You know, I'm going to die here." It's funny, isn't it? That's what the Aussies wanted me to do in 1932. "And now I'm going to do it on my own accord and in my own good time." And so he did. I asked Harold Lawood what he thought about Jack Fingleton. "He saved me," he said. "But then I knew he was a remarkable man because I played against him." I asked him to explain. "Well, he was brave," he said. "I could hit him, but I couldn't knock him down. And he didn't complain. Not like some," he said. Harold Lawood and I were lucky to have known Jack Fingleton. He was my guide and mentor when I first came to Australia with Keith Miller, along with Keith Miller. Ah, the great Miller. You'll understand by now, I've always kept the best of company. Miller was my boyhood hero. I saw him with Bradman's team in 1948 when he pierced the gloom of an English cricket season with his combination of athleticism, skill, and glamour. There's never been a more charismatic cricketer than Keith Miller. The writer and critic Neville Cardless, a good friend of Miller's, called him the Australian in excelsis. Another perceptive observer of life and cricket, the writer, broadcaster, and poet, John Arlott, summed up Miller's appeal by saying, "If I had to choose one cricketer to take a wicket, hit a six, or make a catch to save my life, it will be Keith Ross Miller." It's hard to explain how grim Britain was in those post-war years. It was like living in a catacomb. Nor is it possible to fully demonstrate the way one Aussie cricketer enabled us to forget our sorrow, to set aside our tribulations simply by being there. If Keith Miller was beloved in Australia, he was revered in Britain. He came to know Britain well during the war, as did many Australian servicemen. As a member of the Royal Australian Air Force, Keith Miller flew missions over enemy territory. These airmen have a very special place in our hearts. Last year, I attended the Battle of Britain Remembrance Day ceremony and stood next to a 90-year-old Englishman who, as a young fellow, had flown Spitfires. He said the British airmen had a particular admiration for the Australian air crews based in Britain. I asked him why, and he said, "Because they didn't have to be there, did they? They volunteered." Miller belonged to an exceptional generation, one which gave us the freedom we now take for granted. The lives of those men and women who were forged in that war, and they were forever shaped by their experience. Keith Miller once told me how he loathed the word pressure being applied to the modern day sportsman. He said, "How can there be pressure in playing a game? Pressure is having a Messerschmitt up your backside at 10,000 feet. Well, he didn't say backside. That's what pressure is. One final observation. Whenever I think about Keith and Jack and the way they guided me through my early days in Australia, I find myself smiling. I remember Jack calling me early one morning, unable to sleep because he was to appear as a guest on the Parkinson show that night. I asked him what concerned him most. He said that because he'd been on the show once before and it had been successful, he wanted to give the audience something new. Like what? I asked. He thought for a minute. "Anyone ever cark on your show?" he said. I find that sense of humor to be one of the most attractive aspects of the Australian character. It was never more evident than when Australia achieved the impossible by putting a smile on the face of the Olympic Games. The Sydney Olympics nowadays are regarded as the shining example of what a game should be. Why? Well, the English journalist Simon Barnes gave this explanation in The Times, and he said Australia had the guts to debunk the twaddle that goes with the Olympic Games, to take away the pomposity and celebrate a concept that means far more to us than the banalities about world peace, that is to say, humour. Dame Edna Everidge once said, and we must never tire of quoting the classics, that Australians are good at sport because of the sun, the diet, the healthy outdoor life, and the total lack of intellectual stimulation. In doing so, the Dame was merely explaining the cultural cringe which existed in Australia 30 years ago. How different now. Take the Dame herself. 30 years ago, a struggling housewife in Moonee Ponds. Today, the superstar of superstars. Why you needed to import Oprah Winfrey when you've got the Dame on your doorstep beats me. Better looking, funnier, and I guess cheaper, I don't know. Mr. Barry Humphreys, the Dame's representative on Earth, is himself sufficient rebuke to the notion of Australia being devoid of great performing talent. He is, in my view, one of the more significant entertainers of our time. A unique combination of stand-up comedian, satirist, actor, and fashion icon, who's created in Dame Edna a perspicacious commentator on the foolishness and the folly the world we inhabit. If Barry Humphreys and his cast of characters stood alone, it would be sufficient to give Australia a privileged place in the world of showbiz. But across a wide area of performing arts, Australia has produced actors, directors, singers, writers, musicians to stand proud in any company you care to mention. Which begs the question, of course, was the complaint about the cultural desert ever true? I remember interviewing Sir Robert Helpman in 1979 and asking him that question. "Cultural desert," he said. "How could any country giving birth to Melba, Sutherland, and me be that?" Fair enough, and besides, anyone coming to Australia and looking at the Opera House and believing he's arrived in a land of Philistines is neither thinking nor seeing straight. Conceived in the 1960s, it was at the time a bold, even outrageous declaration of the brash imagination of a young and emerging nation. Today, it's simply one of the wonders of the world. Now, writing this speech and trying to convey the humor and good nature of the Australian people, and searching to explain why I still believe this is the lucky country, has been difficult at a time of terrible disaster in Queensland. And yet, to the outside observer, nothing becomes your people more than the way they respond to the horrors of flood and fire. In 2009, the bushfires of Victoria. Today, the floods in Queensland have reminded the world of the resilience and the courage of the Australian people. It's reassuring to the rest of us, helpless spectators though we are, to be reminded that such appalling tragedies bring out the best in human nature, demonstrating that the notion of community, the principle of being a good neighbour, are not merely slogans, but the practical means by which we survive in desperate times. It also reminds us just how a penal colony became a great nation. The history of this place is the triumph of a few who, by common purpose and strength of necessity, built a prosperous nation in a remarkably short time and against all the odds. In 1836, Charles Darwin visited Australia. It was not quite 50 years old, and yet he wrote, "As a means of converting vagabonds from the most useless in one hemisphere into active citizens in another, and giving birth to a new and splendid country and a grand center of civilization, it has succeeded to a degree unparalleled in history." But even Darwin could not have imagined what the next 150 years and more would bring. In the 30 years I've been visiting Australia, I've seen it shrug off an inferiority complex embodied in the aforesaid cultural cringe to become a self-confident nation, beholden to none other, a very individual identity with an economy to envy, particularly if you live in Europe. That said, why do I sense a predilection for self-criticism, an assumption that things could be better, a longing for things to improve? Instead of a nation dancing a jig at its good fortune, I've got a sense of Australians sitting this one out, waiting. Waiting for what exactly? The author Bill Bryson, in 2000, in his book on Australia called Down Under, noted this trait when he wrote, "You encounter it constantly in newspapers, TV, and radio, a nagging conviction that no matter how good things are in Australia, they're bound to be better elsewhere." Bryson, who loves and admires Australia, said the only thing Australians lack is perspective. And I think maybe that he's right. Curiously, for a nation not lacking in ambition, it seems to be awaiting inspiration from someone or something. You can be sure whenever it finds whatever it is it's waiting for, nothing will stop it. In trying to sum up what I feel about my second home, I keep coming back to Scott Fitzgerald's observation that America was a land commensurate with our ability to wonder. And so I believe is Australia. If we think for a moment of those 11 ships arriving in 1788 with their forlorn and desperate cargo, and then look around us and think what the next 200 years might bring, it's surely not stretching our sense of wonder to imagine Australia as one of the most powerful and progressive nations in the world. Ah, you say, but that would be a miracle. Well, think back 200 years. Look around you now. Is not what you see miraculous? Thank you.